Alright, this video is brought to you by Mubi, a curated online cinema streaming exceptional films from around the world. You can try it out for free for a month by clicking the link in the description below.
Giant light beams, flying bison, airbenders, I think I got Midnight Sun Madness. I'm going home to where stuff makes sense.
I don't think there's any doubt about the immense quality of Avatar The Last Airbender and how well it holds up after all these years. Of course, its recent resurgence in popularity has been largely due to its availability on Netflix, but back when it first aired on Nickelodeon in 2005, a time before streaming on demand, I would sit down after school to specifically, at the right time, watch this show. As it was right before dinner time, my mom would often call me to dinner in the middle of the episode, telling me that the silly cartoons are on TV every day and I should just watch them another time. But as I would try to explain, Avatar The Last Airbender is not a silly cartoon.
Now, check this out!
Okay, maybe it is a little bit of a silly cartoon.
He's kidding, right?
But simultaneously, Avatar was a show with unique and some serious world building. On a macro level, it establishes a complex world with different and well-developed cultures, finding a mix between its own creative inventions and real-world cultural and historical inspiration. A world where we see the consequences of imperialism, colonization, and war. While on a character level, it explores themes of death, loss, the scars of war, parental abuse, revenge, and forgiveness. It is a show that can move you to tears, and simultaneously, in contrast to most cartoons on television at the time, to miss an episode of Avatar was to miss a chapter in a book. A missed episode would be a hole not only in the unfolding story, but also in important character developments and backgrounds. Avatar The Last Airbender was a show that was working towards a grand and epic conclusion, and looking back at it, it was probably the greatest kid show ever created. In Avatar, we find a world at war. Although the series opens on a relatively small scale at the Southern Water Tribe, it doesn't take long for it to start exploring a bigger, wider world. The four nations that it explores each have distinct, complex, and well-developed cultures and geographies, all four of them based around one of the four elements: water, earth, fire, and air. Now, the cultures of the show are in many ways inspired by real-life nations. The Southern Water Tribe, of course, was inspired mostly by Inuit culture. Although there's also Native American elements as well. The Southern Water Tribe is mostly like Inuit culture, as it is only a small community living in igloos. This stands in stark contrast with the Northern Water Tribe, which is much bigger and more advanced in its architecture. Now, within the narrative of Avatar, there are several explanations for this. The Southern Water Tribe was always a smaller sister of the Northern Water Tribe, as it was founded by those who left the Northern Water Tribe because of social and cultural restrictions.
Grand-Grand wouldn't let your tribe's stupid customs run her life. That's why she left. It must have taken a lot of courage.
Furthermore, the Southern Water Tribe was also weakened because of continuous raids and the kidnapping of waterbenders, who naturally would be mostly responsible for building the infrastructure of the tribe. Now, when it comes to real-world inspirations of the Northern Water Tribe, comparisons have been made with Venice in Italy, and there are also again Native American elements, like totem poles. But its primary inspiration is the Harbin International Snow and Ice Festival that is held yearly in northern China. Now, the air nomads are primarily inspired by the Tibetan monks and their mountaintop monasteries. The Avatar himself is of course very much inspired by the Dalai Lama. The air nomads are the most spiritual nation. Just as Tibetan monks, they practice meditation and ultimately try to detach themselves from earthly concerns.
Also, they apparently had pretty good senses of humor.
Although this is by definition not possible for Aang, as he is the Avatar. As we know, the Air Nomads were destroyed by the Fire Nation, and Aang was the last airbender, until his son worked to restore the Air Nation. Now, the two biggest nations in Avatar are the Fire Nation and the Earth Nation. The Fire Nation, as an island group, lies in the western side of the Avatar world. Its primary inspiration is Japan, as the Fire Nation is mostly compared with the imperialistic period of Japan before and during World War II. It is a nation that is at the cusp of an industrial revolution, a new prosperity that the Fire Nation used to colonize the rest of the world, to quote-unquote share this prosperity. A great video about the world building of the Fire Nation was made by the YouTube channel Hello Future Me, so definitely check him out. He goes into more depth both on the Earth Nation and the Fire Nation than I ever could. A particular aspect of the Fire Nation, however, that I want to point out and that draws inspiration from Japanese culture is the importance of shame and honor. Particularly for the character of Zuko, this is of course a central concept, and a ritual taken from Japanese culture, for example, is the cutting of the ponytail as a sign of shame. Finally, the Earth Kingdom is most often compared with China, comparable in its vast landmass and architecture and clothing. Pasingse looks much like Beijing and also has a great wall and a palace that very much looks like the Forbidden City. The weak Earth King of Pasingse, who eventually loses power, also has a striking resemblance to the real last emperor of China. The governmental structure of Pasingse is comparable to that of later dynasties of Imperial China, where the emperor's servants, the eunuchs, controlled everything behind the scenes. Now, of course, the geography of the Earth Kingdom is vast, and in various areas we find different influences from other cultures. And Kyoshi Island, for example, is inspired by Japan and its Japanese war fans. So, although I've compared the four nations to primarily the Inuit, the Tibetan monks, Japan, and China, this is just the baseline of cultural influences. The show's creators mix mythologies and cultures with the same enthusiasm as they mix random animals. The origin of the Fire Nation, the Sun Warriors, are heavily inspired by Aztec culture, for example, and although the Fire Nation as an island group is mostly compared to Japan, its geography was just as much inspired by Iceland, it turns out. The vast world of Avatar also has many areas inspired by other cultures, like the Swamp Tribe that is a mix of Baju rednecks and Native American tribes, and the Sunken Library that looks very much like the Taj Mahal. To be honest, as I'm writing this right now, I'm realizing more and more how impossible it is to fit all the cultural influences that inspire Avatar in this one video. The cultural influences are so rich and diverse in its details. The attention that the show's creators have paid to this is mind-boggling. So from here, I'll refer you to many great YouTube videos that have been made about it. In this video, what I've tried to illustrate mostly is how the creators of Avatar build rich and grounded complex cultures that make the world of Avatar, despite all of its magical elements, feel grounded and real. Like it is a world that we could be walking in, that we could be living in. And this brings me to the next element of greatness, another reason why Avatar holds such a special place in our collective hearts: its magic system of bending the elements.
No, that's the problem. You've got to stop thinking like an airbender. You've got to face it head on. And when I say head on, I mean like this. Whoa!
So when I was a kid, I wanted to accomplish three things. I tried to become Super Saiyan, I waited for my Hogwarts acceptance letter, and I tried to bend the elements. I failed at all of these things, but it does illustrate how great an idea it was to combine martial arts with bending the elements. When I was looking at the live action movie of Avatar made by M. Night Shyamalan, which was disastrously bad in every way, from its narrative to its action, the first moment I knew it was going to be as bad as it was when I saw this shot in the promotional trailer. Bending was so ridiculously weak-like, and it takes like 10 benders to move one rock. But even more so, the bending is completely disconnected from the movement. Benders throw around a whole series of movements or flailing martial arts dance movements only for a rock to fly in one direction. And this problem of a disconnect and delay between the martial arts movements and the actual bending was, among others, a horrible mistake in this film. And it is this failure that only further illustrates the greatness and the depth of the bending systems within the animated series. Within the television shows, bending is a direct extension of your movements and the energy within your body. The bending system is built around the real-life Chinese concept of qi, which refers to the metaphysical energy that flows through the human body. Qi is the root of bending, and therefore all bending of the elements is a natural extension of the energy in the body. So all the movement of the elements that are being bent, therefore, needs to be a natural extension of the movement of the body. In one of the greater episodes of the series, Sokka has a crisis because he is the only one that is unable to bend the elements, and he then decides to find a swordmaster to teach him the ways of the sword. Now, as the swordmaster explains, the sword as a weapon is an extension of the body.
First thing you must learn is that your weapon is an extension of yourself. You must think of it as another part of your own body.
And bending is an extension of the body's energy in the same way. The animators of the show take great care in matching the martial arts movements to the bending of the elements. As each of the bending styles matches particular cultures, philosophies, and personality types, the show's creators use different martial arts styles to base the different bending styles on. So the water movements are inspired by Tai Chi, earthbending is inspired by the Hangar style of Kung Fu, and firebending on the Shaolin style of Kung Fu. And finally, airbending is based on Bagua Kung Fu. Just as with creating the world, its culture and mythology, the bending system is magical but also feels deeply grounded in real-life martial arts and philosophy. And it is this groundedness that makes bending appealing and attractive to try to do yourself. The final great aspects of the bending system are, of course, the little details. Ideas such as metal bending and blood bending were amazing, and especially the latter one added an additional darkness to the show. The bending system is not only grounded within real-life martial arts, it also adds significantly to character personality and character development. As, for example, the introduction of bloodbending is used to test Katara's moral boundaries.
Congratulations, Katara. You're a bloodbender.
And although the show's creators said that Azula's firebending is blue because it just made the fighting scenes more clear and distinguishable, it is not hard to link it to her character, as blue fire burns hotter and means a more complete burning of carbon, leaving no residue, so it perfectly matches with her power and ruthless precision. Now, Avatar is of course a kids' cartoon, originally broadcast on Nickelodeon for an audience between 8 and 16. Yet, simultaneously, it is a show that explores grown-up themes like imperialism, war, revenge, death, and grief. As a kids' show, death is almost never explicitly present in the show's battles. You won't see anyone burn to a crisp or get a sword to its head. Yet it is present in the background, in character background, and through insinuation.
Take me as your prisoner.
I'm afraid I'm not taking prisoners today.
It is a show with stakes, a war where people do get tortured or killed. The show's creators even seem to be aware of this in the series, that they are balancing creating a kids show while simultaneously wanting to have more serious themes, like death, present in the series.
Oh. Did Jet just die? You know, it was really unclear.
Some YouTubers that I've watched argue that Avatar is a show that grows with its audience through the season. A comparison can be made with Harry Potter. The book series grows with its audience and becomes darker, dealing with more serious themes. It becomes less kid-friendly, as it were. The first book of Harry Potter was aimed at children between 10 and 13 years old in 1997, and the last book aimed at 18 to 24 year olds when it was released in 2007. The clearest transition can be seen in the third movie, where a bright and colorful cinematography gives way to a much darker and more somber tone. And the YouTube channel Nerdstalgic points out that something similar happens in Avatar. But I don't think it's really true that Avatar becomes more of an adult show throughout its three seasons. Yes, it definitely gets more depth and develops its characters deeper, giving us some heartbreaking moments, but it explores the serious themes as well in the first season and can be completely silly and funny in the last season as well. Avatar is a show that continually throughout its three seasons balances silly, funny, and arguably childish moments with serious themes and character developments. Part 1 of Sozin's Comet, the series final, is in fact a beach party.
Sitting around the house has made us pretty lazy, but I know just the thing to change that. Beach party!
Even in its final episodes, its grand conclusion, it is a show that can at any moment switch between, for example, Aang questioning the nature of killing in the name of good, and the next moment show us some slapstick comedy.
Wait, someone's missing from your group. Someone very important. Where's Momo?
And then the next moment again we are moved to tears by the reunification of Zuko and Uncle Iroh. This balancing of comedy and darker themes works in two ways. Beside the fact that a great story needs to create a rollercoaster of emotions where the audience is laughing at one moment and crying the next, by introducing this balance within a kids show, it shows that the creators do not underestimate its audience. Avatar, just like Harry Potter, knows that children are perfectly able to deal with these adult themes like death and war, certainly when they are presented in a not too violent, kid-friendly way. Simultaneously, because these themes are present, it becomes a show that ages very well. It is a show that you can rewatch as an adult and thoroughly enjoy once again. It does not become too childish. Now, although I don't think that the show as a whole becomes more darker in tone until the final episode, all its characters go through significant character developments where they go from playful kids to more and more realizing the stakes of this war, and specifically their personal role in it. As Nerdstalgic points out, more and more they carry the stakes of this war on their back. The character arcs of these protagonists is by far the greatest element of Avatar: The Last Airbender. Like I said before, with Avatar, to miss an episode meant something. Back when you had to be in the right place at the right time to be able to see the next episode of Avatar, when you miss one, you would, in contrast to most other kids' shows, miss an important character development and a chapter in a bigger story. Yet, it is important to note that Avatar was not completely serialized. The ending of each episode was not just a cliffhanger for the next one. The creator struck a careful balance between each episode being its own individual story and driving the overall story forward. And I think that this allowed the creators to, in a relatively small runtime of three seasons, to develop many well-rounded three-dimensional characters that all had their strengths and weaknesses and all went through a significant character development. Many of the episodes simultaneously push the narrative forward, but are also stories with a beginning, middle, and end of their own. Many of these individual episodes focus particularly on one or two characters and thus make room for specific character arcs. Throughout the show, each character gets enough specific attention to fill their own character development. For example, for Katara, despite her amazing part in the final Agni Kai, the most important conclusion of her character development was in the Southern Raiders episode, a couple episodes before the final. Throughout the show, we see the pain Katara is suffering because the Fire Nation killed her mother. Her primary motivation is to become a powerful waterbender to never again be at the mercy of the Fire Nation. However, throughout her journey, she also faces the responsibility of the newly gained power, how far she is willing to go using her bending against the Fire Nation to gain vengeance. And this is particularly explored in the episode The Puppet Master, where she finds an old woman called Hama whose experience of suffering under the Fire Nation is similar to Katara's. She was young when the Fire Nation raids took away waterbenders until she was captured as well, and eventually left to suffer and rot in a Fire Nation cell. Katara felt the same helplessness when she watched the Fire Nation soldier kill her mother. Both Katara and Hama eventually found the power and skill set to overcome this helplessness and fight back. Yet Hama becomes a cautionary tale to what the need for revenge can drive you to.
Stop! Please!
And Katara vows to never use bloodbending again. This episode is so important for Katara's character development because it is referred back to in the Southern Raiders episode where she finally gets the chance to take revenge on her mother's killer. In the episode, she does in fact use bloodbending, illustrating her willingness to cross her own moral boundaries when it comes to bringing her mother's killer to justice. Ultimately, she doesn't kill her mother's murderer, not out of forgiveness, but to keep her own moral integrity.
But I didn't forgive him. I'll never forgive him. But I am ready to forgive you.
The same way as Katara's character arc starts as a small child with the loss of her mother and develops throughout the show, Sokka's journey starts at the same time. Sokka, even as a little kid, tries to be a brave warrior, yet because his father was taken away by the Fire Nation, he never had a role model or teacher to show him how to be a warrior and how to be a leader. Yet he feels like he needs to be the one to adopt this role and tries to hide his insecurity with arrogance.
Girls are better at fixing pants than guys, and guys are better at hunting and fighting and stuff like that. It's just the natural order of things.
Throughout the series, he needs to learn first to humble himself and then to ultimately learn his own strengths. And he also had to deal with his girlfriend turning into the moon.
That's rough, buddy.
Now, a key episode that focuses on Sokka's development is the first encounter with Jet, who seemingly represents the leader Sokka wants to be so bad, but isn't. Jet, in a way, offers him a place next to him as a leader that has followers that do exactly as he commands. As the YouTuber Kato points out, Sokka's story is about learning to lead your peers as equals instead of subordinates. And in this episode, Sokka recognizes what kind of bad moral judgments having overly loyal subordinates and this kind of leadership can lead to. Another very important episode for Sokka is the Day of the Black Sun, where, despite his growth, the invasion is ultimately a failure, and for Sokka, a failure as a leader. He bears the responsibility for this failure, as a lot of his allies, including his father, are captured. He ultimately frees the prisoners together with Zuko, and it is this episode that mostly concludes his character development towards being an adult leader. Now, however important these episodes are, my personal favorite Sokka episode will always be the one where he learns sword fighting by Master Pian Dao. Sokka in this episode feels down because he realizes that he is the ordinary one, the one without the strength and power to do the heavy lifting against the problems that arise. Toph, Aang and Katara are at this point well-developed, powerful benders and have left Sokka behind as the regular one. And then it is suggested that he finds a master to learn the art of sword fighting. After humbling himself before Master Pian Dao, he rediscovers his own strengths and a new road to mastery. And I think that this episode is so inspiring because Sokka represents, in a way, all of us. All of us who can't bend the elements, did not get our letter to Hogwarts, and were not able to successfully Kamehameha. In all seriousness, it is this episode with Sokka that teaches us that you do not have to be uniquely special or talented to fully develop your potential and to achieve mastery of a skill set. Now, Toph's character is a little bit different because in many ways, her development is the smallest one. She enters the show as an incredibly confident, powerful, no-nonsense, punch-through-a-wall earthbender.
Shake your knees high, Twinkle Toes!
Despite her being blind, she can see more than most people through her feet, and after inventing mental bending, she only becomes more confident. Relatively, Toph doesn't change as much throughout the show, or even her whole life. She always remains the brash, talking, confident, no-nonsense earthbender.
If you're not tough enough to stop the rock, then you could at least give it the pleasure of smushing you instead of jumping out of the way like a jelly-boned wimp!
Yet, there are some important lessons she learns and takes with her. For Toph, her most important character development is to accept help from others, as she, despite her abilities and confidence, was always overly protected by her parents.
My daughter is blind. She is blind and tiny and helpless and fragile. She cannot help you.
Yes, I can.
She sees help as something condescending. Her journey is to learn that to accept help and even to be taken care of is not a sign of weakness.
There is nothing wrong with letting people who love you help you. Not that I love you, I just met you.
Aang, of course, as the Avatar, has the central arc of needing to defeat the Fire Lord and bring balance to the world. His most important character development is leaving behind his natural ability to evade conflict and to adopt the responsibility of his power. It is natural for air nomads, both in their personality and fighting style, to evade. Aang, of course, ran away from his responsibility as being Avatar, and in the first season he is still avoiding the dire situation of the world at war, as he is still a kid and mostly just wants to do fun stuff. It is for this reason waterbending, which comes from a philosophy of going with the flow, is much easier for him to learn than earthbending, where you have to stand your ground and punch your way through the problem. Another great problem to overcome for Aang is to accept being possibly destructive. For air nomads, violence, and especially taking a life, is something to be avoided.
This goes against everything I learned from the monks. I can't just go around wiping out people I don't like.
Sure you can. You're the Avatar.
The necessity of stopping evil by destroying it, by killing, is impossible for Aang. And it is for this reason that he has just as much struggle with learning firebending as with learning earthbending. He is afraid of not being able to control his own power. Ultimately, Aang does find another path to defeat the Fire Lord without killing him, despite all his ancestors advising him to take decisive actions against the biggest threat of the world, Roku pointing towards his own failure and the consequences that it had for the world, of which the most direct consequence was in fact the genocide of Aang's people. Yet, ultimately, he still chooses for a different path, taking away the Fire Lord's bending. This is not to say his character development isn't fully completed. Through learning a different approach to firebending by the Sun Warriors and learning energy bending to take away the Fire Lord's bending, he still takes decisive action without taking a life. And ultimately, this was the best way for Aang to end it, as his biggest failure was him running away from his responsibility that led to the destruction of his people and culture. He redeemed himself in a way that was also in line with his people's beliefs of non-violence, that every life has worth. Just as with Katara, Aang's journey is about becoming the best and most powerful version of yourself, without letting this power and the evils of war corrupt your beliefs.
It's time for you to look inward and begin asking yourself the big questions. Who are you? And what do you want?
Ah! And this brings us to the greatest aspect of Avatar, the greatest character development possibly in the history of animation, the story of Zuko and his uncle Iroh. Now, upon rewatching the show, I remembered again how long and subtle the journey of Zuko is. Most of the first season, and especially the first episodes, he is fully a villain, consumed by rage and looking the part. There is no real reason to root for him or believe in a better destiny for him than to be defeated by Aang. When I originally watched the first season of Avatar as a kid, I could not have predicted Zuko's redemption. The presence of Iroh at this point is no more than a soothing voice and some comic relief.
Prince Zuko, you're really going to get a kick out of this. The lotus tile was in my sleeve the whole time!
But it is not a changing force in Zuko's character and morality. An important reason for this was that Zuko was the primary antagonist of the first season, although in the later episodes he does get overshadowed in evilness by Commander Zhao. It is only in the last episode of the first season where real room is created for Zuko's moral journey. A new primary antagonist is introduced. At the start of season 2, we have learned the reason for Zuko's anger and rage. His quest to capture the Avatar is his only chance to regain his honor in the eyes of his father, who brutally scarred him and banished him for speaking out against him in a meeting.
I won't fight you.
You will learn respect, and suffering will be your teacher. I looked away.
This is shown in the episode The Storm, where Zuko's youth is put in parallel with the youth of Aang. It is this episode that is built upon in the second season, where Zuko slowly starts grappling with what he wants and what is right. The audience learns more and more how Zuko is just as much a victim of the Fire Nation as many others, and how he is pulled between two parents. His mother, who also turns out to be the granddaughter of Avatar Roku, being a force of kindness and love in his life, while his father being a force of disapproval and abuse. It is this lack of love from his father that put Zuko on a path of anger and rage for so long, and in season 2 he struggles more and more with it. But Zuko's redemption arc is not linear. He doesn't just suddenly realize his faults and turns good. It is a struggle of growth that pushes him back and forth, which makes his redemption arc so much more realistic. At the end of season 2, when there finally seems to be a breakthrough for Zuko, and a choice to choose the right way, he doesn't. And this makes Zuko's story only better, because it is only after getting what he always wanted that he can start to realize that that is in fact not what he wants. As another YouTuber, Riley J. Dennis, points out, if Zuko turned to Team Avatar before he returned to the Fire Nation and experienced what it was like to be fully accepted as Prince Zuko, rightful heir to the throne, there would always have been this open question, this what if. The epitome of this struggle is found in the island episode where he, Mei, Azula, and Ty Lee visit the beach.
I'm angry at myself!
Why?
Because I'm confused. Because I'm not sure I know the difference between right and wrong anymore.
An episode that even succeeds to humanize the tragedy of Azula's character development.
My own mother. I thought I was a monster.
Even you fear me.
No, I love you, Azula. I do.
Furthermore, the fact that Zuko initially chooses the side of Azula and the Fire Nation, betraying his uncle, makes their later unification even more heartbreaking.
You have no right to judge me, uncle. I did what I had to do in Ba Sing Se, and you're a fool for not joining me.
Zuko's redemption would never have been as great if it wasn't for his betrayal of Uncle Iroh, his uncle, the man who regarded Zuko as his own son, who functions as the heart of Avatar, teaching Zuko tough and us the audience his life lessons. Throughout the first season, he is always the wise, calming voice who, through his calmness, seems untouchable.
Please sit. Why don't you enjoy a cup of calming jasmine tea?
He cares for Zuko like a dad and is a father figure to almost everyone. Yet it isn't until the Tales of Ba Sing Se episode that we see how vulnerable Iroh actually is. It is still kind of mind-boggling how strong this moment was with Uncle Iroh and how it seemingly came out of nowhere. The Tales of Ba Sing Se seems like a filler episode with a range of small stories. One moment we are watching Toph and Katara having a girl's day out and Uncle Iroh bestowing some wisdom on random passerbys. And the next moment we get our hearts broken.
Happy birthday, my son. If only I could have helped you.
Little soldier boy, come marching home. Brave soldier boy, comes marching home.
And then after this we watch Aang herd zoo animals and Sokka doing haikus. It is such a small moment tucked away in all these small tales, and it was probably primarily written just as a remembrance moment for Marco, yet it turns out to be probably one of the most important moments of the entire show. It is a moment where we see all the humor, calm and wisdom of Uncle Iroh disappear, and that underneath is a vulnerable, heartbroken man who had to deal with a great loss. And it is because of this moment that Zuko's betrayal at the end of the season and their eventual reconciliation hits us so much harder.
I am so, so sorry, Uncle. I am so sorry and ashamed of what I did. I don't know how I can ever make it up to you, but I...
Avatar will always be a kids show that can both move us to laughter and move us to tears at any age. And it is one of the greatest kids shows ever made. Alright, thank you to Mubi for sponsoring this video. Now, with all the streaming wars going on and all the different streaming services trying to get your attention, Mubi is one of a kind. It is an online curated cinema that premieres a new film every day that is handpicked by its curators. No longer will you be bored out of your mind because Sokka is off learning sword skills from Master Pian Dao. You don't have to endlessly browse through other streaming services scrolling past low quality comedies that you've already watched. Instead, you will get a daily updated selection of great cinema, from timeless classics to cult favorites and acclaimed masterpieces. There's always something worth watching right at your fingertips on Mubi. Now, new on Mubi is the Mubi Library, where you can find, watch and download many of their previously featured movies at any time, on any screen or device anywhere. Go to mubi.com/storytellers just to try it out for free for 30 days. You can cancel at any time if you don't like it, but I'm sure you will. So that is mubi.com/storytellers, or simply click the link in the description below. It hugely helps out the channel. Thank you all for watching, and we'll see you guys in the next video.